quantità di denaro riciclato ogni anno è stimata dal 2 al 5% del PIL, ovvero il prodotto interno lordo globale. Il 2% del PIL globale è grosso modo uguale alla somma del PIL di Turchia, Filippine, Bangladesh, Sri Lanka e Pakistan. L'emorragia di denaro da paesi in via di sviluppo è di oltre mezzo trilione di dollari all'anno. In gran parte, il denaro è diretto verso economie occidentali tramite un complesso sistema di istituzioni offshore. Nel 1952, il futuro presidente del Kenya, Jomo Kenyatta, venne incarcerato dalle autorità coloniali britanniche. Diventerà il simbolo della lotta per l'indipendenza.
Jomo Kenyatta is viewed as Kenya's father of independence, so to speak. He used to go by the name Johnstone Kamau. He used to be a water meter reader in the colonial government's municipal council. He was also fairly well spoken. I believe that's part of the reason why he was selected from amongst the political intelligentsia at the time.
A seguito della scarcerazione, lo squattrinato Kenyatta strinse amicizia con Malcolm MacDonald, l'ultimo governatore britannico del Kenya. Nel 1963, Kenyatta viene eletto primo ministro e in seguito presidente del Kenya indipendente. Nello stesso periodo, Malcolm MacDonald diventa alto commissario. Il governo e la pubblica amministrazione del nuovo paese sono gestiti prevalentemente da personale che i britannici definiscono lealisti. Anche dopo l'indipendenza, la Gran Bretagna mantiene un numero di installazioni militari. 60 anni dopo l'indipendenza, la famiglia Kenyatta è tra le più ricche del Kenya.
The Kenyatta family have vast investments in land across the country, right down to the coast, all the way up to the what was called the White Highlands. They own the biggest milk company in Kenya. They own one of Kenya's biggest banks. They have a chain of hotels. They're building a sub-city right now, just right outside the bounds of Nairobi City. There's always been an open question about how Jomo Kenyatta was able to become such a rich person. One or two years after becoming president, his salary at the time doesn't match the kind of wealth that he has. There have been memoirs written by, people from his administration that say that he essentially would, engage in land grabs of very, very prime pieces of land owned by members of the settler community, etc.
In un rapporto desecretato della CIA si legge che i sussidi forniti da governi esteri intesi a finanziare la distribuzione delle terre degli ex colonizzatori ai keniani che non ne avevano furono usati dalla famiglia Kenyatta e i loro collaboratori per acquistare terre per se stessi. Oggi i Kenyatta sono i maggiori proprietari terrieri di tutto il Kenya, in possesso di oltre 500.000 acri di terre di grande valore. Mentre molti, tra coloro che lottarono per la liberazione del paese e per il possesso di terre, non hanno ricevuto niente. Jomo Kenyatta è deceduto nel 1978. Suo figlio, Uhuru Kenyatta, ha seguito il padre nella carriera politica.
The country's president, Uhuru Kenyatta, was among the world's rich who were named this week in the Pandora Papers.
According to the Pandora Papers, Kenya's president, Uhuru Kenyatta, and six members of his family have been linked to 13 offshore companies.
And what was revealed is that the family had invested in offshore structures. For, if you're including the extended family, as early as the mid-70s. Uhuru Kenyatta was listed as a beneficiary of a trust that, so to speak, belonged to his mother upon her death.
Uhuru Kenyatta si definiva difensore della trasparenza e la lotta alla corruzione era il tema centrale del suo mandato di presidente.
This dragon, this beast called corruption, is an animal that we intend to slay.
President Uhuru Kenyatta welcomed the leakage of the Pandora Papers, saying the publication of the papers will go a very long way in enhancing the financial transparency and openness required in the country and around the globe.
In Kenya, due terzi della popolazione vive in povertà con meno di $3.20 al giorno. Il 70% delle famiglie kenyote sono esposte a malattie evitabili dovute a povera alimentazione e scarsità di cibo. La legge stabilisce che il presidente debba fornire ogni anno al Ministero delle Finanze un elenco delle proprie attività finanziarie.
What we own, what we have is open to the public and we declare every year, and I've always said if there is an instance where somebody can say that what we have done or obtained has not been legitimate, say so, we are ready to face any court.
He said that he's made his wealth declarations, but we've never seen them. Secondly, families of politically exposed persons don't have to declare their wealth. Between the year that he got in 2013 and today, those have been very good years for the Kenyatta's wealth. There is this feeling that the Kenyattas, as well as other political elite, they have become fabulously wealthy at a time when Kenya is suffering from the worst levels of corruption that it has seen in years. How it's been described is that there's been one rule for the elite, especially the elite that's connected to power, and another for everybody else. So that's what the perception is. I think I'll leave it at that.
I Kenyatta sono persone politicamente esposte, o PPE in breve. Essere politicamente esposti significa svolgere una funzione pubblica e di conseguenza essere a maggior rischio di concussione o corruzione.
Politically exposed persons in theory have access or potential access to public funds within particular countries, and our investigations have come up with lots of evidence that unfortunately there are PEPs who have been stealing public funds and moving it into places like the UK, either to hide it, to clean it, or to spend it. So PEPs are incredibly significant when it comes to the money laundering picture. And that's why professionals in the regulated sector, in the private sector, are supposed to do enhanced due diligence whenever they have a client who is a politically exposed person. Unfortunately, there are multiple cases that we have found where that clearly hasn't happened. I could think of one, former political official who was accused of embezzling a lot of money. This was splashed all over the internet. Within the 5 years following that, this person was able to open several UK bank accounts, took out a few mortgages on UK houses, opened a UK company.
Can you share who that person was?
Because of slap suits in the UK, which I'm sure you're really aware of, we're very aware of them, unfortunately. I have to literally libel check everything I say, learn it like a script and then say it, so I can't.
Even if that is already in the public domain?
Yeah. It's a big issue. Journalists like yourselves, NGOs like us, are often targeted by very expensive lawyers in London, unfortunately, who take on dubious clients and basically pursue NGOs, pursue journalists for daring to mention the corrupt dealings of these people.
I Kenyatta non sono l'unica dinastia politica del mondo in via di sviluppo ad aver accumulato ricchezze e terre ben al di sopra delle loro fonti di reddito conosciute. Azerbaijan è tra i principali produttori di petrolio e gas naturali. I combustibili fossili sono in tale abbondanza che affiorano addirittura in superficie. Il Regno Unito è il maggiore investitore estero dell'Azerbaijan, con capitali che superano la metà degli investimenti esteri.
The Aliyev family is the richest family in Azerbaijan. They came to power in 1993 when Heydar Aliyev, a former KGB general and secretary general of Azerbaijan Soviet Republic, orchestrated a coup.
Nel 1993 Heydar Aliyev prese il potere con un colpo di Stato. Poco prima della morte del padre Heydar, suo figlio Ilham Aliyev assunse la presidenza e da allora è sempre rimasto al potere. British Petroleum, o BP in breve, è presente in Azerbaijan dal 1992 e dopo il colpo di Stato siglò un accordo segreto con il nuovo presidente. Oggi BP è la maggior società petrolifera estera in Azerbaijan.
The political opposition has always said that British Petroleum was responsible for the state coup. They brought Heydar Aliyev to power. I remember in 1993, during that difficult electoral and coup period, the British private security companies were doing something in Azerbaijan. Maybe they came to protect someone, high-level officials of British Petroleum. Or maybe they came to help protect members of the Aliyev family. We don't know. Nobody knows what is in this contract between British Petroleum and Aliyev. It's like biggest state secret in Azerbaijan.
Nel loro sito web, BP definisce questo contratto come il contratto per il nuovo secolo. La famiglia Aliyev ha enormi interessi finanziari in Azerbaijan.
Who is the owner of five biggest commercial banks in Azerbaijan? It's the Aliyev family. Who is the owner of the biggest private transportation company? It's the Aliyev family. Who is the owner of the biggest five-star hotel networks in Azerbaijan? Again, it's the Aliyev family. They privatized the state's biggest banks, and after they made themselves owner of these banks, they start using these banks to launder money.
Heads of state and other major figures have deposited vast assets offshore.
It's according to a review of nearly 12 million files from around the world. It's the latest report by the International Consortium of Investigative Journalists.
The Pandora Papers expose a London property empire worth nearly $700 million amassed by the ruling family of Azerbaijan.
So one of the properties that we looked at was on Conduit Street in central London. This property was bought in 2009 by a company owned by one of the associates of the presidency of Azerbaijan. And then this property was basically sold shortly after that to the daughter, who was 19 at the time, Arzu Aliyeva. And eventually it was sold to the Crown Estate, which is, you know, owned by Queen Elizabeth II.
Gli Aliyev ricavarono un profitto di 31 milioni di sterline.
There was another property in Mayfair, Maddox Street, which was transferred to Heydar Aliyev. He was the 11-year-old son of the president of Azerbaijan. So, you know, overnight, the tenants started paying their rent to an 11-year-old boy. In Kensington, there was a cluster of properties in one development called Thornwood Gardens. Over here in Holborn, there was a hotel.
Quando il quotidiano La Repubblica chiese ad Ilham Aliyev un commento sulle rivelazioni dei Pandora Papers, Aliyev rispose: alcuni potentati occidentali sfruttano queste istituzioni o mezza verità per screditare l'immagine dell'Azerbaijan e comprometterne la posizione. Ci accusano? Ci vogliono assoggettare? Vogliono imporci la loro volontà? Ma io dico no, difenderò l'Azerbaijan, la sua sovranità, la sua indipendenza e le sue scelte fino a che avrò vita. E tutte queste sporche calunnie non hanno nessun significato per me né per il popolo dell'Azerbaijan.
In the Pandora Papers, we saw dozens of politicians and world leaders, current and former world leaders, with wealth offshore. Offshore service providers are supposed to conduct enhanced due diligence and really scrutinize the sources of wealth of the politically connected people that they provide services to.
Nei Pandora Papers è evidente che i fornitori di servizi offshore non applicarono grande solerzia nell'accertamento dei propri clienti.
You know, there was some light googling, running names through risk databases and things like that. The people conducting these checks are really doing checks to be seen to be doing checks.
At the moment, it's very hard to pursue large banks and big firms for money laundering offences because we do not have a failure to prevent money laundering offence within UK law, which Transparency International very much believes we should have. Our research identified 582 UK individuals and firms who were involved in major money laundering cases. They have people who will turn a blind eye to anything they may discover, proceed anyway, and those who maybe don't do enhanced due diligence when they should. You will find individuals and firms that will actually deliberately go out to try and get the services of those who are potentially involved in corruption and criminality, because it's big business, it's big money.
There are 84,000 UK properties that are owned anonymously. Now, of course, some of those will be owned with the legitimate money, but it's quite possible that a lot will be owned with suspicious funds.
La capitale dell'Azerbaigian è un luogo singolare. E non ci riferiamo solo alla presenza dei molti gatti randagi, perché c'è un numero molto superiore di polizia e forze di sicurezza. C'è un poliziotto in qualsiasi strada, ad ogni angolo, persino sotto i ponti. Ci sono parchi abbelliti con pietra serena e marmo per tutta la città. Solo nelle periferie di Baku la fiaba viene smentita dalla realtà.
In 2005, Azerbaijan signed the UN Convention Against Corruption. One of the requirements of that treaty was to implement financial declaration for all state officials. Parliament ratified that treaty. Yet, until today, 17 years later, nobody is declaring their wealth. The first journalist who exposed the huge corruption in the government was killed at the front door of his house. After that, we saw that all journalists who spoke about stolen assets, they have a problem. They are put in jail. Their lives become extremely difficult. They are prosecuted, they are blackmailed with private family issues.
L'Agenzia Nazionale Anticrimine, o ANA in breve, ha il compito di indagare il riciclaggio di denaro sporco.
I think there are reasonable grounds for the NCA to investigate assets owned by or linked to the Aliyev family in the UK. It's not always entirely clear how the presidential family has made their wealth. Some of that money, at least, came through money laundering systems, laundromats, which are known to have funneled illicit money out of Azerbaijan.
Volevamo chiedere ad Anna perché non sia stata aperta un'indagine sui beni della famiglia Aliyev nel Regno Unito, ma Anna ha rifiutato di parlare con noi.
When I was in Azerbaijan, the British Embassy occasionally invited us for breakfast with ambassador and other British officials. They would tell us that they were afraid that if we did a strong investigation, we would put ourselves in trouble. They never give us any support to investigate corruption. British politicians, including British politicians in the Council of Europe Parliamentary Assembly, tried to wash the negative image of Aliyev. You know who is the biggest lobbyist in Azerbaijan from the UK? It's the son of the Queen, Prince Andrew, Epstein's friend. He is also a friend of Aliyev, a very good friend.
In Azerbaigian il presidente viene eletto ogni 5 anni e ogni volta, sin dal 1993, il nome del presidente è quello di Aliyev. Nell'elezione del 2008 Aliyev ottenne l'89% dei voti, nel 2013 l'84,5% e nel 2018 ottenne l'86% dei voti. Durante le elezioni del 2018, Emin Huseynov indagava per conto di una organizzazione non governativa su possibili brogli elettorali.
We observed the elections and discovered irregularities. After that, the government closed down our NGO. They confiscated all our equipment. They put most of us in jail. I decided to escape. The police in Azerbaijan were looking for me, as if I was the number one terrorist in the country. They put my photo at the entrance of all metro stations. The taxi drivers and the bus drivers had my photo. I changed my appearance. I grew a beard and dyed my hair blonde. Secret agents were waiting in front of the Swiss embassy. They asked the guard, "Have you checked him?" And the guard replied, "This is not the guy you are looking for. The guy is a foreigner. Switzerland protect me." And after 10 months, the head of the Swiss Ministry of Foreign Affairs came to Azerbaijan, and he was able to take me with him to Switzerland. After that, President Aliyev illegally canceled my passport and he stripped me of my citizenship.
Ritroviamo la passione degli Aliyev per gli immobili londinesi, come l'uso della segretezza dei servizi offshore per occultare la propria ricchezza, in un'altra dinastia del mondo in via di sviluppo, gli Sharif del Pakistan.
The Prime Minister of Pakistan has been disqualified from office. The court also disqualified the country's finance minister, Ishaq Dar.
This verdict was unanimous. All the five judges declared that Prime Minister Nawaz Sharif is not an honest and sagacious person, and hence he should be disqualified.
Nawaz Sharif è stato eletto tre volte primo ministro del Pakistan. Durante la sua carica negli anni 90, Nawaz Sharif ha privatizzato molte industrie statali.
The privatization policies which were initiated by Mr. Nawaz Sharif during his stints as prime minister during the 90s, that is the start of corruption, where a lot of state holdings, they were portrayed as if they are making losses, and then they were handed out to different political backers of Nawaz Sharif, his friends and his business associates.
Il governo di Nawaz Sharif approvò una legge per cui il fisco in Pakistan non poteva chiedere l'origine di denaro di provenienza estera.
One thing which we need to remember, and this is very, very important. When you're in the power, you can make laws according to your will. You can actually manipulate the system. You can tell, you can bribe the people. You can get cuts from wherever you want. And this is what the Sharifs has been doing. And this is what they've been accused over the years.
It's a close-knit family affair. In the case of Hudaybiyah paper mill, once you look at the directors and shareholders, it's only the entire Sharif family, the immediate blood relations, and a few cousins who are also mentioned as directors. To look at the shareholding of Ramzan Sugar Mill, that gives you an idea that it is run by chief executive officer Mr. Hamza Shahbaz Sharif.
Shahbaz Sharif è il fratello minore di Nawaz Sharif. Lui era capo dell'assemblea del Punjab, mentre il fratello era primo ministro. È accusato del riciclaggio di decine di milioni di dollari tramite lo zuccherificio di Ramzan, di cui la famiglia Sharif è proprietaria.
Accounts were opened in the name of these low-level, low-wage employees who do not come into the tax net. Money used to be deposited in those accounts, and finally they used to land in the accounts of either Mr. Hamza Shahbaz Sharif, Mr. Suleiman Shahbaz Sharif, or Mr. Shahbaz Sharif himself. In fact, these files which you see here, it gives the names, it gives the banking documents, the challans, everything which is mentioned in these, all the banking records, the names of the low-wage employees. Here is one example, look at it. Mr. Masroor Anwar, he is depositing this in name of Mr. Shahbaz Sharif. This is 1.6 million rupees. This was deposited in Habib Bank of Pakistan on 27th April 2017 when Shahbaz Sharif was the chief minister. This is another deposit, 13th May 2016, in the name of Mia Muhammad Shahbaz Sharif, an amount of 6,52,451 rupees deposited in an account by Mr. Masroor Anwar. 1 crore and 90 lakh rupees being deposited in the account of Mr. Shahbaz Sharif by Masroor Anwar. Now, you might ask, who is Masroor Anwar? Masroor Anwar, according to this investigation by the Federal Investigation Agency, was a low-level employee of Sharif family. Your own family member is the finance minister, and your other brother is the prime minister. So then entire banking chain was there to facilitate them. And I was talking to one of the sources in the investigation because once they investigated the bankers as to how it was happening under their nose and why they didn't stop all these activities, they said that people used to come with gunmen into the banks. And one of the females, the investigator said, she was crying, a banking official, that what we could have done. The bank managers, they used to get a call from top executives in the bank. The banks themselves were part of this nexus of covering up the corruption of the Sharif family.
The so-called Panama Papers contain allegations of money laundering and tax evasion.
Involving world leaders and where some of them are accused of hiding their money in many cases in an effort to avoid taxes.
It was a surprise for the people in Pakistan because it came out internationally. It had much more credibility because previously over the years, the Sharif family had been using the news that all these allegations against them are politically motivated.
Sharif's three children are named in the Panama Papers. His family owns properties in London through offshore accounts. Sharif's daughter denies owning the London properties. Documents from her allegedly date back to 2006 and show she is a trustee of the properties, not an owner. But those documents are written in a font called Calibri, which was not commercially available until 2007.
If you look at 1992 and 93, this is a very important time. Mariam Esser's grew 21 times, and there's no justification for that. In a single year, you are not a business owner. There's no business under your name, but 21 times your assets are going up.
Nel 1992, Mariam Nawaz compie 19 anni. A seguito delle rivelazioni apparse sui Panama Papers, gli organismi investigativi pakistani indagarono sulle finanze della famiglia Sharif.
The joint investigation team basically found out that Mr. Nawaz Sharif could not justify the assets he had made from known sources of income. That was one of the main charges.
The matter was sent for criminal prosecution. In criminal prosecution, there was a trial which went on for almost a year. And in that trial, not even a single answer came from Mr. Sharif about the origin of his wealth or the explanation of those four Avonfield flats in London.
Where is the money trail? That they have never been able to prove.
Si pensa che la famiglia Sharif sia tra le più ricche del Pakistan, ma l'origine di tanta ricchezza resta un mistero.
The flat that you're living in at the moment in Mayfair was actually named in the Pakistani paper, The News, last year as one of four which was illegally bought by your father through various Swiss and offshore companies.
Why don't people who are actually blaming us for that go to the court and prove it?
But do you know who owns the flat that you're living in?
Well, that is not the question right now.
Why not? But it's the question I'm asking you. Do you know who owns the flat?
Well, it's on a rent. I'm earning on a rent basis, which comes from every quarter from Pakistan.
You're renting it personally, or the money comes from Pakistan?
The money comes from Pakistan. I'm just like any other student living with his parents. I doesn't necessarily have to know about what the facts and who owns the flat and who pays for the rent and who pays for my living. The family deserves all this. It is not my fault that I was born in a rich family, in a wealthy family. My grandfather earned that with the hard work, sheer hard work.
When you ask them that where you got this money from, they will start telling you the story of their late grandfather. At the time of independence, we came from India, we have businesses. Seriously speaking, there's no business in the world which has no money trail.
If you look at their tax filings, it doesn't come out as a big industrial family. The Sharifs never featured in that rich families of Pakistan. But now if you make a list of the richest families in Pakistan, then definitely Sharifs would feature in the top 10, maybe in the top 5, because exact amount of their holdings as to how much is hidden in Luxembourg, in UK, in UAE, in Saudi Arabia, what is in different bank accounts in the United States, that is not known. Whether it is $4 billion or $5 billion, that is not known.
Nel dicembre del 2018, a seguito delle rivelazioni dei Panama Papers, Nawaz Sharif e sua figlia vengono condannati a 7 anni con accuse di corruzione. A Nawaz Sharif è concessa la libertà su cauzione per curarsi a Londra, dopodiché rifiuta di tornare in Pakistan. Da Londra, Nawaz Sharif sostiene che la sua caduta è il risultato di un complotto dell'esercito pakistano.
Bijli ka bill bijli bankar gareeb par gir raha hai. Bajwa sahab, jawab aapko dena hoga. Dawai na milne se. Dawai na milne se. मेरे पाकिस्तान का गरीब पर रहा है। बाजवा साहब, जवाब आपको देना होगा। गरीब की रोटी 10 रुपए की हो गई है। बाजवा साहब, जवाब आपको देना होगा। और जनरल फैज, ये सब कुछ आपके हाथों से हुआ है, जवाब भी आपको देना होगा। आपने नवाज शरीफ को बागी कहना है, जरूर कहिए। गद्दार कहना है, जरूर कहिए। इश्तिहारी कहना है, जरूर कहिए। हाई जैकर कहना है, जरूर कहिए। लेकिन नवाज शरीफ अपने गरीब और मजलूम आवाज की आवाज बनता रहेगा।
Ci siamo rivolti all'onorevole Priti Patel, ministro dell'interno, per chiederle perché Nawaz Sharif, il cui permesso di soggiorno è scaduto da 2 anni, non sia stato estradato dalla Gran Bretagna. Priti Patel, che ha sempre dimostrato prontezza nell'espellere i richiedenti asilo, non ha intrapreso alcuna azione contro Nawaz Sharif. Sia l'onorevole Patel che il ministero dell'interno hanno rifiutato un'intervista. Ci siamo rivolti all'Agenzia Nazionale Anticrimine. Volevamo sapere perché non sia stata avviata una seria indagine sul patrimonio di Nawaz Sharif. L'agenzia non ci ha concesso un colloquio. Nawaz Sharif non è l'unico esponente della famiglia che considera Londra una nuova patria.
London is the second home of House of Sharif. Hassan Nawaz is here, Hussein Nawaz is here, Hussein's children, Zakaria and another son is here, right? Hassan's children are here. Nawaz Sharif is here. And then if you look at Ali Dar, who is the son-in-law of Nawaz Sharif, Asma Nawaz Sharif, who is the youngest daughter of Nawaz Sharif, she's here. Ishaq Dar is here. Then Shabazi family is here as well. Suleiman Shabazi is here. Ali Imran, who is actually the son-in-law of Shabazi Sharif, who also lives in this country. Shabazi Sharif's daughter, Rabia Imran, is also in this country. And she is actually on a run and wanted in Pakistan. Ali Imran is wanted in Pakistan. Ishaq Dar is wanted in Pakistan. All these people are wanted in Pakistan.
Sitting in Pakistan, in third world country, you look at it as to why most of the people who are wanted by the courts in Pakistan, by the law in Pakistan, they find a refuge in London, UK. It doesn't make sense to me.
Londra è la destinazione preferita di persone politicamente esposte e delle loro famiglie che hanno accumulato enormi patrimoni ben oltre le loro fonti di reddito. Questi patrimoni vengono spesso riciclati o trasferiti offshore verso o tramite territori dipendenti dalla Gran Bretagna, dove l'origine e proprietà vengono occultate e il denaro reinvestito nell'economia globale. La fuga di capitali causa grande preoccupazione nei paesi in via di sviluppo.
We know that there's a huge capital flight, and it's not just specific to our time period. It has been historical. It directly impacts the economy because you see, the issue is that if our currency is not doing well, and we have a serious issue of sustaining the value of Pakistani rupee, that has a correlation with capital flight.
Il gruppo di azione finanziaria internazionale, o GAFI in breve, un'organizzazione intergovernativa di vigilanza sul riciclaggio e finanziamento del terrorismo con sede a Parigi, ha incluso il Pakistan nella lista dei paesi sotto osservazione.
Our financial systems have been made more accessible. We have sharing of information with almost everyone. We are pursuing many money laundering cases as far as we can pursue, because of course the missing element still is the cooperation from the other jurisdictions. That is not forthcoming. And sometimes we wonder that we are in grey list, but the money that has been taken from here is in countries which are not in the grey list. So that is something that, you know, sometimes is like, okay, so why are we in the grey list then?
Abbiamo chiesto un'intervista a Gafi, ma hanno rifiutato di parlarci. Ci sarebbe piaciuto chiedere come sia possibile che Regno Unito, Svizzera, Lussemburgo, tra gli altri paesi, siano considerati puliti quando è noto che questi paesi sono attivi nel riciclaggio e miliardi di dollari di denaro sporco vengono reinvestiti ogni anno attraverso le loro economie.
The money is stolen here and it is hidden in the developed countries, in the developed world. If that is happening, it's not just the fault of Pakistani system that the money is able to go out. What I question is the double standards. So for example, if you ask on one side from countries like Pakistan to have more checks and be more open, we expect in return the same from other countries when we are investigating someone. We will write a mutual legal assistance request to, let's say, Switzerland, and we will say that we have information that Mr. A has a bank account in Switzerland in such and such bank. We don't know the branch, we don't know the account number, but he's definitely in the system and his identity, date of birth, everything is shared and we will seek information. And maybe 1 year or 2 years after, we will receive certain questions from saying, can you identify the branch name, or can you give us the account number? Whereas we have said in our first request, we don't have those. When Pakistan Tehreek-e-Insaf government came into power, we formed an informal arrangement with the UK authorities called Justice and Accountability Initiative, and NCA also set up a small anti-corruption unit within NCA, which was to assist in Pakistan on its request.
Il Ministero dell'Interno e Agenzia Nazionale Anticrimine hanno il compito di gestire le richieste di assistenza legale reciproca con altri paesi esteri. Il Pakistan ha inoltrato numerose richieste di assistenza legale reciproca sulle proprietà londinese della famiglia Sharif.
The request on Sharif families are taking a lot of time. It's taking way too long to take some simple actions, like, for example, freezing of assets or investigating the assets or the activities in the UK when people are, you know, facing charges or convicted of serious crime in Pakistan. Pakistan did its part. We did our investigation, we did our inquiry, but has there been any investigation on British side? We don't know. What about the Mayfair flats? What about the whole property portfolio of Hassan Nawaz that has come in Panama Papers? The impression that goes to people is that everyone who commits such crimes or who is involved in corruption ends up in London, living in Mayfair flats.
The main issues for developing countries are Western countries. Unfortunately, here in the UK and other Western countries, we can be very good at pointing the finger elsewhere and saying, hey, look at all that corruption over there. But the reality is we are facilitating that corruption. We are complicit in the laundering of public funds because we have a ready-made system ready to go where corrupt individuals can hide, can spend, can clean their money.
London and its role in the offshore world is that it's a money launderer's paradise. It's a money launderer's paradise or haven. You know, it's a place where if you want to stash illicitly earned wealth, you can do so anonymously and you can do so with relatively few checks and balances.
The Russian President Vladimir Putin has launched a major military operation against Ukraine.
Thousands of troops backed by tanks and missile fire have crossed the border into Ukraine on every front.
Ukrainian President Volodymyr Zelensky called on all of its citizens who were ready to defend the country from Russian forces to come forward, saying Kyiv would issue weapons to everyone who wants them.
We've already put in place the largest package of sanctions in our history.
Today, the White House announced new sanctions against members of the Russian elite.
Tying Russian oligarchs directly to assets is proving very difficult because they're all masters of using shell companies and relatives to hide their true ownership.
Le destinazioni preferite di chi volesse occultare il proprio denaro sono i territori di dipendenza britannica, quali le isole Cayman, Jersey e le isole Vergini Britanniche. La Gran Bretagna ha sempre sostenuto che queste giurisdizioni sono autonome e non può influenzarne le leggi.
I listened to the Foreign Secretary correctly detail the importance of avoiding sanctions leakage, and she was asked twice in this statement about British overseas territories. I detected a reluctance to go into detail on that.
I've been very clear that we will absolutely be including overseas territories in all of these measures we're taking.
Ci siamo rivolti al Ministero degli Esteri per chiedere se sono disposti a intraprendere azioni simili contro denaro di origine illecita da altri paesi. Il Ministero degli Esteri ha rifiutato di concederci un'intervista. Per poter sequestrare i patrimoni russi, il Regno Unito ha varato una legge contro i reati economici, con lo scopo di facilitare l'identificazione e sequestro di denaro illecito nel Regno Unito.
The recent Economic Crime Act basically passed into law that any trusts that are involved in the ownership network of a property now have to declare the beneficial ownership to HMRC. However, that trust register is not public, so we're not entirely sure what information is even on it, whether that information is verified or how effective it is. Overseas trusts that own UK property will also have to register, well, under law will have to register there. I don't know how much that will be enforced. In practice, it's hard to say.
It's not really clear how exactly that's going to be implemented. And, you know, so for example, if we look at the register of persons with significant control over UK companies, a lot of people complied with that. A lot of companies complied with that, but a lot didn't. They declared what appear to be potentially nominees.
Now, the UK government has promised to reform Companies House. At the moment, Companies House is not empowered to check and verify the information that is submitted to it. It's quite possible to write down, like I said, Mickey Mouse or Donald Duck, not the real beneficial owner, and no one's really going to check that information.
So when we look at setting up something similar for the property register, you know, we're likely to encounter the same kind of problems. How many of them are actually going to comply? And if they do, how do we know that that's the real, you know, the real beneficiary who owns that? How do we verify that? It's not hard to see why UK companies have become a vehicle of choice for corrupt actors, for money launderers to use to move and hide their wealth, because the enforcement is weak.
Volevamo chiedere ad Anna cosa, secondo loro, potrebbe contrastare il fenomeno del riciclaggio qui nel Regno Unito, ma hanno rifiutato la nostra richiesta. Anna fa parte del Ministero dell'Interno ed eravamo curiosi di sapere se Anna potesse agire autonomamente dal Ministero oppure se le sue azioni legali erano guidate da interessi del governo piuttosto che dall'interesse per il perseguimento di reati. Nel febbraio del 2022 il quotidiano The Guardian ha scritto che l'ex ministro conservatore Lord Foulkes, che nel 2017 e 2018 tentò di istituire un registro pubblico dei proprietari di nazionale estera, venne avvicinato da funzionari statali di 4 dipartimenti governativi che gli consigliarono di abbandonare l'idea del registro dei proprietari terrieri. Lord Foulkes dichiarò al quotidiano che è veramente ironico che la nostra reputazione di garanti dello Stato di diritto ha l'effetto di attrarre personaggi che hanno scarsa considerazione per la legalità e provengono da paesi che ignorano la legalità in toto. Ci siamo rivolti a Agenzia Nazionale Anticrimine, Ministero degli Esteri, l'onorevole John Glenn, segretario economico del Ministero del Tesoro, e l'onorevole Priti Patel, ministro dell'Interno. Ma nemmeno uno di questi soggetti ha accettato di partecipare a questo documentario. Quando abbiamo chiesto un'intervista ad Imran Khan, all'epoca primo ministro del Pakistan, questi ha accettato.
Hello, my pleasure to meet you. How are you?
Very well, thank you. And you?
Good, thanks. So you're not going to be in the cabin?
No, we'll be out.
So what is this, sort of like a documentary?
Yes,
it's
a documentary about individuals who've become very wealthy by being at the center of power and currently have a lot of wealth in London, especially in property.
Corruption is not just an issue for Pakistan.
It is an issue for all the poor countries. In fact, I've come to this conclusion that countries are poor only because of corruption, and corruption of the elite. It's the corruption of the powerful that destroys a country, not the corruption of the weak. When I, as a prime minister, if I want to make money out of, from my country, steal money and then send it abroad, I can only do it if I weaken the state institutions that would check my corruption. So the institutions get corrupt and they get weaker and they cannot stand in front of the powerful. The richer countries must come forward and treat money taken out of poor countries, money laundered out of poor countries, the same way as terror financing and as drug money. Because these two, terror financing and drug money, affect the richer countries, the laws are very strict. But there's hardly any attempt to stop this plunder of the poor countries. I feel that there is no incentive for rich countries to repatriate money or take action against these people, because they benefit from them. There are countries that are benefiting from money stolen from our countries and which are parked there. They're benefiting from billions of dollars which flow into their properties and their businesses, stolen from this country. So what incentive would they have? We are the ones who suffer. And this is the dilemma. We don't have the resources to get the money back, and they don't have any incentive to send it back to us. So this is the big problem which the entire developing world is facing. I guess it's a question of now hiring more expensive lawyers abroad. But you see, when you look at the laws, they basically favor, I'm talking about the richer countries as a whole, they tend to favor the crooks. It is so complicated to get your money back.
Imran Khan has raised this issue in almost every forum that the rich countries must take care of poorer countries. And the care involves that the looted money that is now invested in the rich countries must be returned to the original countries. In Panama Papers, the properties of Sharif's are categorically mentioned. And all these properties are in the heart of London. And everyone, including the British government, knows that these properties are actually bought from laundered money. I think international politics play a big role here. So some countries, they say that what is ours, and what is yours is also ours. So this is the case with British government right now.
The United Kingdom, that the United States increasingly, that various other territories in the West are not only refusing to dismantle or make more open and accountable these kinds of systems, but are actively supporting territories that allow for the inflow of illicit financial wealth. And the world needs to be able to wake up to something like this. They'll shout about the Jeff Bezos and Elon Musks and Apples and all sorts of things, but they're eerily silent about the wealth that's being taken out and invested because it helps their countries. That's not right. We become victims twice, where when we are asking for our wealth to be returned, it becomes so difficult for us to have that happen. The Congolese still don't have the wealth from Mobutu Sese Seko's reign returned. The Nigerians still don't have wealth from Sani Abacha and many other people returned. I'd say the same probably of the Dos Santos regime. Countries that actively build these systems, actively finance these systems and protect them, don't do enough to be able to make them more open and accountable. That's just not right.
Offshore Leaks ha denunciato più volte che personaggi politicamente esposti sfruttano giurisdizioni segrete per occultare la propria ricchezza, riciclarla e reinvestirla nell'economia globale. la gran parte del sistema finanziario internazionale e molte delle maggiori giurisdizioni finanziarie segrete sono controllate e regolamentate da interessi occidentali. Imran Khan ha spesso denunciato i sistemi di riciclaggio e i centri finanziari offshore. Il suo governo ha affrontato le istituzioni e i governi occidentali perché restituissero e rivelassero sia denaro sporco che proprietà non dichiarate provenienti dal Pakistan. Ha inoltre adottato una politica estera indipendente che ha irritato gli Stati Uniti, rifiutando di ospitare basi CIA sul suolo pakistano. Il 7 marzo del 2022, l'ambasciatore pakistano presso gli Stati Uniti rese pubblico un comunicato classificato nel quale Donald Liu, alto funzionario del Dipartimento di Stato, lo informava che le relazioni tra i due paesi sarebbero migliorate solo se Imran Khan fosse rimosso.
Khan actually accused the US of being behind a conspiracy to get him ousted from power.
The Prime Minister of Pakistan accused the US of working with the opposition to remove him from power.
There is absolutely no truth to that allegation.
We are not going to let propaganda, misinformation, and disinformation, lies, get in the way of any bilateral relationship we have, including with the bilateral relationship we have with Pakistan.
Prime Minister Imran Khan has been ousted from power. Lawmakers elected the opposition leader Shahbaz Sharif as the country's new prime minister.
A new dawn has started. A new day is coming. Allah has answered the prayers of millions.
Quando lunedì 11 aprile Shahbaz Sharif, il fratello di Nawaz Sharif, fu nominato primo ministro, il quotidiano The Guardian scrisse: la reputazione di amministratore coscienzioso con grande amore per la poesia, che spesso apre le riunioni ufficiali recitando famosi poeti rivoluzionari urdu. Le prime parole rivolte al Parlamento sono state: dobbiamo liberarci dei limiti imposti dai desideri. Imran Khan ha dichiarato che la sua rimozione è l'esito di un complotto manovrato dall'estero.
The US Embassy was calling members of my party backbenchers who were not happy, and they were the first ones who then jumped ship, and they were the ones who then offered $1 million each to buy my other members of parliament who actually jumped ship later on. And then Donald Liu's conversation with our ambassador, the next day the no confidence motion is tabled in the assembly.
You have made significant allegations there. When
it's not
will
allegations
you show
we
me
have
hard
this
evidence.
Why would I want to blame the US if I did not have hard evidence? This was an official message with note takers given to our ambassador, message received by me, by our president, given to the Chief Justice of Pakistan. This is real. Not only was a democratically elected government removed through a conspiracy, we have been replaced by a bunch of criminals. 60% of the cabinet which is sitting right now is on bail. The Prime Minister was about to be sentenced in a corruption cases of billions of rupees, and his son.
The Sharif doctrine is that you buy different people in all the important positions of power, whether it's in the media, you have your sympathetic journalists who continue to argue for you that the country can only be saved by the wisdom of the Sharif family. The generals, when they retired, they are also accommodated. The judges, once they are retired, they are also accommodated. The journalists, they are also given a government position and they willingly take it. So it's the entire Sharif doctrine which gives them the sense that they can even get away with murder in Pakistan. Nawaz Sharif has learned that even though if you are out of power, if you manage to gain time, and if you manage to delay the cases in the courts of law, and once you come back into power, you can manage to get a clean check. So I think this time also, the same strategy is being followed by the Sharif family. I think those in power, they think that they can get away with the crimes they have done. And Sharif family has been benefiting from them because of their international friends who have been coming to their rescue to strike the dirty deals.
Qualcuno ha detto che per accumulare ricchezza oltre ogni possibile limite si deve stare in stretto contatto con chi fa e applica le regole. Una delle prime azioni del governo di coalizione di Shabazz Sharif, ancora fresco di nomina, fu di approvare un emendamento per limitare il potere dell'Ufficio di Responsabilità Nazionale, che era incaricato di indagare reati commessi da titolari di cariche pubbliche. L'emendamento, che fu approvato nel giugno del 2022, avrebbe avuto effetto retroattivo. L'emendamento stabiliva che i tribunali avevano tempo un anno per concludere un procedimento e stabiliva anche che in caso di prove insufficienti fornite al momento dell'arresto, l'ufficiale esecutore dell'arresto rischiava 5 anni di carcere per falso in atto pubblico. Il dottor Mohammad Rizwan, il 47enne ispettore capo responsabile dell'indagine su Shabazz Sharif e la sua famiglia nel processo sugli zuccherifici Ramzan, è deceduto il 9 maggio del 2022 per infarto. Un altro investigatore, sullo stesso caso, ha avuto un infarto ed è ancora in condizioni critiche. Malik Masood, tramite i cui conti bancari, dicono i procuratori, sono transitati 3,7 miliardi di rupie pakistane riciclate a favore di membri della famiglia Sharif, ha cooperato con gli investigatori, quando anche lui fu colto da infarto e in seguito morì il 7 giugno del 2022. Il 49enne cominciò a lavorare agli zuccherifici Ramzan servendo il tè e guadagnando circa $300 all'anno nell'impresa di proprietà della famiglia Sharif. Stando a Wealth Report, Londra è la capitale mondiale della ricchezza, battendo New York per il primo posto. Londra è il parco giochi preferito dagli oligarchi politicamente esposti e rispettive famiglie del mondo intero. Gli Sharif del Pakistan, gli Aliyev dell'Azerbaijan, i Kenyatta del Kenya e molte altre attuali o passate famiglie con stretti legami politici che hanno accumulato ricchezze superiori alle fonti di reddito conosciute, possiedono immobili di prestigio per miliardi di sterline. Londra vanta il più alto numero di investitori immobiliari internazionali provenienti da 45 paesi diversi. Le giurisdizioni britanniche dipendenti continuano ad offrire segretezza finanziaria e servizi per evasione fiscale. Nel Regno Unito, 84.000 immobili sono di proprietà anonima. Il governo britannico ha promesso più volte un giro di vite sul riciclaggio, ma ogni volta ha mancato di legiferare sulle promesse fatte o ha varato leggi talmente blande da essere, di fatto, inutili. La Gran Bretagna resta la capitale del turismo antidiffamazione, dove i ricchi imbavagliano gli accusatori. Londra è sempre un rifugio sicuro per le elite mondiali che sono cadute in disgrazia nei loro paesi d'origine. Il Pakistan, sotto la guida di Imran Khan, ha tentato per anni di rimpatriare il denaro riciclato portato in Gran Bretagna. Molti altri paesi in via di sviluppo hanno fatto lo stesso, ma senza successo. Per fare questo documentario ci siamo rivolti a numerosi enti governativi e ministeri, ma nemmeno uno ci ha risposto. Gafi, l'organo intergovernativo contro il riciclaggio e il finanziamento del terrorismo con sede a Parigi, nel primo rapporto redatto dopo l'estromissione di Imran Khan, precisò che il Pakistan soddisfaceva le raccomandazioni di conformità e poteva essere tolto dalla lista dei paesi sotto osservazione.